I want to ask you what part of the country you come from.
I originate from Canada. I guess where that is.
Well, I know where Canada is. I've been there myself.
Well, travel for a slave.
Solomon Northup is an expert player on the violin.
I was born a free man, lived with my family in New York.
Be good for your mother.
Until the day I was deceived.
To Solomon.
Kidnapped, sold into slavery.
Well, boy, how you feel now?
My name is Solomon Northup. I'm a free man.
And you have no right whatsoever to detain me.
You're no free man. You're nothing but a Georgia runaway.
Went down to the river Jordan.
And that servant
that don't obey his Lord
shall be beaten with many stripes.
That's scripture. The condition of your laborers, it's all wrong.
They're my property.
You say that with pride.
I say it as fact.
Take!
Man does how he pleases with his property.
You come here.
Master Abbott.
I say come here!
Days ago, I was with my family in my home. Now you tell me all is lost.
If you want to survive, do and say as little as possible.
My soul arising.
Well, I don't want to survive.
A year
I want to live.
You knowed something.
I did as instructed. There's something wrong. It's wrong with the instruction.
Master brought you here to work. Any more will earn you 100 lashes.
I know what it like to be the object of Master's lash.
No!
In his own time, good Lord will manage them all.
I will survive! I will not fall into despair! I will keep myself hardy till freedom is opportune.
Tell a story about slavery, and I wanted to find an interesting angle into the narrative. And I thought about a free man, a man who has a family who's kidnapped into slavery. And the reason why I chose this angle is I wanted that person to be everyone in the audience. And as I was thinking about the idea, my wife found this book called 12 Years a Slave, and there it was.
Solomon Northup is my name.
Solomon Northup was a free black man in Saratoga, New York, in the middle of the 19th century.
And he's a musician, and he's in a place where he has a sense of equality.
Mr. Northup, I have two gentlemen whose acquaintance you should make.
And in 1841, he was lured by two sort of showmen with the prospect of earning some money by playing music for their shows.
We could give you $1 for each day's services and $3 for every night played at our performances.
Solomon agrees to go and play with these two guys. When they get to Washington, they have a sort of celebratory dinner.
Gentlemen.
He feels very ill, goes to bed, and he wakes up chained in a dungeon.
Well, boy, how you feel now?
And that's the beginning. what happens to him.
You ain't a free man. You're nothing but a Georgia runaway.
Come on, move it.
He shipped himself to New Orleans, and his reality is, I mean, everything is new to him.
My name's not Platt. My name...
Your name is Platt.
His name has changed. His papers taken away from him. All identification lost, and he ends up sold into slavery.
You see things through his eyes. You experience the environment and the cruelty and the brutality and the dehumanization of people on that journey.
We've all felt that there's never been a film about slavery that really dealt with it in such an unflinching way. And the perspective of coming from outside of it, someone who's not exposed and is suddenly thrown into this world, we can all identify with.
$1,000 for Platt. My fairest price.
Mr. Chapin.
Yes, sir.
You can take these two up to the mill, start them working.
When Solomon gets onto the slave plantations, you know, he has really essentially three different slave masters, all of whom treat him in different ways.
I am the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob.
You have in the character of Ford someone who is a kind of benevolent figure who wants to be compassionate.
My great thanks, Master Ford.
My thanks to you.
Then you have someone like Edwin Epps, who is just essentially a sadist, a very brutal person.
Man does how he pleases with his property.
Damn you!
And then you have figures like Judge Turner, who is a sort of mysterious figure.
What you earn is yours to keep.
But what is consistent is this idea that they know that there is something different about him. Just inherently, they're aware of it. And they all feel that it is something that they need to destroy.
I will have flesh, and I will have all of it.
He was clearly very intelligent, and he recognized very quickly that his life could be snatched away from him on any given day. And so I think he felt like the strongest thing he could do was to stay alive, and that if he stayed alive long enough, perhaps he would find his way out.
Solomon realizes that, you know, there's a possibility of him seeing his family again, so he holds strong. The events are astonishing and cruel.
I survive! I will not fall into despair! I will offer up my talents to Master Ford! I will keep myself hardy till freedom is opportune!
For Solomon, a lot of this journey is not just that journey to get home, but really that journey to understand the importance of the privileges that we all enjoy as Americans, but also our families.
There's this modesty, but a certain kind of formality to him. It's beautiful, it's heartbreaking. The book is a testament to Solomon Northup, but also about a testament to the history of what was going on within slavery at that time.
Oh, pick this cotton.
Pick this cotton.
Oh, pick this cotton.
Pick this cotton.
My ancestors were slaves. They're from the Caribbean. And it was just one of those things where within film, it was never given some kind of platform. It kind of deserves as an important historical event, especially in the United States. I just wanted to make a movie about it. For me, it was nonsensical. It was obvious, it was logical.
And cut.
Cutting.
Okay.
This is a story about one of the harshest structures that's ever been created in the history of the world. And it is somebody trying to survive that with their mind intact. And they do, you know. And I feel like that's an extraordinary thing to see, to witness, and to be kind of part of.
Every little once in a while, I mean it. Every little once in a while. Bring a little water, Stevie. Bring a little water now. Bring a little water, Stevie. Every little once in a while, I mean it. Every little once in a while.
Jesus say, come unto me, I am the way. Keep your hand on the plow, oh Lord. When my way get dark as night, know the Lord will be my light. Keep your hand on the plow, oh Lord.
Hello, Mr. Blues.
You know you're a friend of mine. That's why I'm trying so hard to explain why black folks put you down. They say you remind them of the slave traders that took them from their land. That's why they're trying to stay away from you, Mr. Blues, just as far as they can. Oh, Mr. Blues, I know you didn't have nothing to do with that, but I just want to let you know that you're still a friend of mine. They say you also remind them of the raping of their mother. A young lady told me one day, she said, "Chick, the blues remind me of the killing of my brother." They say you remind them of Mega Evers and Emmett Till. They say you also remind them of the day that Martin Luther King got killed. They say you remind them of the bad times and the good times too. But until the good times outweigh the bad times, they don't want nothing to do with you. Well,
you never called me by my name. You said, "Boy, do this and boy, do that," but I never once complained. I knew he had a good heart, but he just didn't understand that I needed to be treated just like any other man. Same skin deep, skin deep underneath. We all the same, we all are the same.
Built on property bought by the taxpayers from the Hayes Investment Company. And of course they had a clause in there that it had to be named the Hayes Auditorium, but that they did not contribute at all to this structure. And in 19 and It was a gymnasium and an auditorium, and anybody who's ever tried to wed those two knows that it's not very easily done. There's a flat surface there for ball players, and there's not any elevation for the stage, people coming in to look at a play or whatever. But anyway, in 1944, it was only auditorium here, and maybe in 1945, I felt like I didn't want to bring my children up in a town that didn't have a library, didn't have any recreational facilities, didn't have any of those community things. And I organized the Bunkie Community Club of Women, and we managed to get the vote on the state library system, get our parish on that. Anyway, one of the things we did was to hold concerts and have concerts here in this Hayes Auditorium. And one point, I had invited Southern University Choir to come. We had people now in attendance of about, I think we had 500 members of our who bought tickets to come to these things. So we had a nice audience. And the choir I had heard when I was at LSU, and Paul's aunt and uncle had taken us out to hear the Southern Choir, and they were just fabulous. So I had invited them to come and sing for us in Bunkie. And the night on the Sunday before we were to have the presentation of the choir, which they accepted my invitation, paid their own expenses, and came in two busloads, there was a great furor over it. And one of the planners, whose name was Brunson, called me and said, "Mrs. Eakin, I understand you're from the North, and you have invited Southern University Negroes to come to Bunkie to put on a performance." He said, "Are you letting them all in the front door of the Hayes Auditorium?" I said, "Well, they're going to sit in the balcony. That's the legal separation, the only choice there is." And I said, "I'm not from the North. I'm Sam Lyles' daughter from Lloyd Bridge." Well, his family and mine, I knew, had been friendly. His sister Vera had visited for all summer nearly at my grandmother's house, so he knew who I was. And then someone else called, and I gained an enormous respect for the man who owned the bar downtown, the most popular one. His name was Biles. And Mr. Biles called me that Sunday evening, and he said, "Ms. Eakin, these men are going crazy in here." He said, "I told them you weren't inviting everybody to sit together in the..." I said, "The black people will sit in the balcony, and the whites will sit on the floor." Well, actually, Frank, the best seats were in the balcony. Anyway, the choir came, but some of my cousins, one cousin, E.L. Lyles, great big old guy, was sitting there with a gun on his lap, and others had pistols and whatnot, just in case there was an uprising. Well, instead, there was a marvelous program. These were highly trained voices, and the black people in the balcony sang along with them. It was one of the most wonderful events that Bunkie's ever had, and that wasn't just my judgment. That was what other people said as well. It's the prettiest thing, a very memorable performance. But that's the way it went in those early days when we had the old Jim Crow laws and people who didn't change. So after that, we've been scared of fire. But there was even a third time when, after this auditorium incident, we came home from church one Sunday evening, and some kids had tried to start a fire right at the back door.
In retaliation for the...
Yeah. And there'd been a cross burned in the front yard by some kids.
During this period?
Yeah.
Here in the front of our house here at 203 South Marsh?
Yeah. My black friend says, how in the world did you with your ideas survive? I said, I never let it worry me. I did what I thought was right, and so help me. I don't give it a thought. I do what I'm not running any popularity contest.